the other Christian sources. For the first 400 years after Jesus' birth, the term Christian was used to describe a wide variety of sects and a large volume of different documents. Through the acceptance of one of the more ascetic branches of Christianity by the Roman ruling class, Christianity eventually became the state religion of its former persecutor. In an effort to unify the faith into a controllable mass, the newly formed Roman Catholic Church held a number of councils. These councils prohibited not only pagans, but also differing Christian sects, and edited a wealth of Christian literature down to the few meager documents which have survived as the modern New Testament. In an attempt to save their manuscripts from the editorial flames of the Roman Catholic Church, certain Christians, now referred to as Gnostic heretics, hid copies of their scrolls in caves. One of these ancient hiding places was rediscovered in our own century, and the large collection of early Christian documents was named the Nag Hammadi Library, after the Egyptian area where it was found. Prior to its discovery, what little was known of the Gnostics came from a few fragmentary texts and the many polemics written against them by the founders of the Catholic Church. There is no reason to consider these ancient Gnostic documents as less accurate portrayals of the life and teachings of Jesus than the New Testament accounts. In a sense, the rediscovery of the Nag Hammadi Library marks the resurrection of a more historical Jesus. An ecstatic rebel sage who preached enlightenment through rituals involving magical plants and who is more analogous to the Indian Shiva or Greek Dionysius than the pious ascetic sage that has come down to us through the Bible's New Testament. Now, you're going to have to check a lot of this material out for yourself if you really want to find out about this stuff. But what I'm going to say, if you look into the matter, you'll find out it's true. Some of the main points of conflict between what became the Roman Catholic Church, which is really the religion of the Apostle Paul, who never met Jesus unless we're to accept his vision of Jesus on the road to Damascus, which left him blinded for 3 days after Jesus' death and resurrection and whatnot. It's like that's his branch of Christianity. He never even actually met Jesus. These other sects had a number of varying beliefs and traditions surrounding Jesus that are so different than the Christianity we know today. It makes it almost unrecognizable. Premier in this is the name Gnostic itself, which, you know, they didn't even really refer to themselves as Gnostics. They were the Ophites or Nassenes or Basilidans or Marconians or any variety of names. And they all, like I said, were different schools with different beliefs that claimed to have set up their schools based upon the teachings that the apostles received from Jesus and went off and started teaching other people. And there's a lot of conflicts there. The main point of contention is even the name they're known by collectively, Gnosis. This means knowledge. And the big point was that the Gnostics felt that one had to gain their own liberation. You couldn't get it by placing your salvation on another person, as, say, Catholics do with Jesus on the cross and their redemption of sin. That you were responsible for your own salvation. That you could only gain that, not through faith, not through believing in something, but through self-knowledge and experience. Another major theological difference is their conception of the whole Garden of Eden myth, which, as we saw, played such an important role in with the anointing oil through our earlier series on the Old Testament references. Now, the Gnostics seem to have reversed the mythology of Judaism back to more its Sumerian roots, for the serpent was considered a beneficent instructor, and the god that prohibited the tree of knowledge and tree of life, a malicious grudger who lied to his own children, Adam and Eve. And all of Gnostic theology is saying that God of the Old Testament is in fact the devil, and the serpent is a good guy. And they saw Jesus as the serpent that Moses crucified in the desert to protect the Israelites from the bites of the fiery serpents. And as the serpent in the Garden of Eden, and they saw him as a wise instructor. So this whole theological thing is back and reversed as well. The female plays a major important role, as the Queen of Heaven did during the monarchic period. We find Sophia, the goddess of wisdom, being a major player in Gnostic theology. And they were completely unhierarchical in the sense that the priest class was always rotating. There were only, you know, the ministers would always change position each week, and both male and female ministers. In fact, in the Gnostic theology, Mary Magdalene, who isn't even mentioned as an apostle in the New Testament, Mary Magdalene is referred to as the apostle, the most important apostle. She plays this same importance as Peter or Paul do in the Roman Catholic theology. And she's referred to as the woman who knew the all. And Jesus obviously shows his obvious deep emotions for this woman and his deep respect for her knowledge. So these major points of contention are all truths of what these early Gnostic documents, unless we can say that might is right, that the victor in any battle is the one that is got the truth, say, then we can't discount these Gnostic documents because they're just as old. Some of them are even considered older. In fact, the Gospel of Thomas in the Nag Hammadi Library is thought to be the oldest Christian document in existence. So unless we're going to say that might is right, then we have to take a real look at these early documents to understand what happened in the early Christian period. So as well as those major theological differences, the one that we're going to be focusing on in this episode is the anointing versus water baptism, because the Gnostic says there is fire in the anointing oil. Through the anointing oil, we're initiated into unfading bliss. But there was only water in the baptism, and it's an empty baptism according to them. And this was one of the major theological breaks between the sect that became known as Roman Catholicism and the variety of other Christian sects that existed for the first few centuries AD and were thought themselves as Christians. And they used this holy anointing oil that was used by Moses, Solomon, and other ancient Levite priests and kings for shamanistic purposes, and which was enriched with THC from the 9 pounds of cannabis used in it. So when we come back, we'll talk about Jesus, the Anointed One.
Tune in Fridays at 4:20 for Higher Ground with DJ Bob on Pot TV. People, keep on.